Hello and welcome to IT Chronicles Tech in 10. We're here at Knowledge 17. I'm Carlos Casanova with Shane Carlson.
Hello.
And Dan Turchin from Neva. Thank you, Dan. So, you know, I know you're into the AI machine learning stuff, and I mean, when a lot of people hear that in the industry, a lot of them get scared. They think of, you know, iRobot and like a lot of those, you know, things. So tell us a little bit about, you know, what it is and what you guys are doing and how you're, when you're engaging with these companies, how you're getting them to settle in and, you know, not be, you know, scared of it and, you know, everything that it is.
So Neva is very intentionally about the most pragmatic application of AI and machine learning for IT possible. Okay. We specifically go to market in support of 3 personas and 4 use cases. Okay. And in part, we do that to address a lot of the kind of science fiction-y and kind of fear-mongering Skynet bot apocalypse kind of, you know, scenarios that are out
sure.
there. So 3 personas: the requester, the one with the problem, mm-hmm. the fulfiller, the human agent responsible for fixing it, and the manager. Mm-hmm. 4 use cases: the virtual agent is an autonomous agent that can answer questions, submit incidents, request goods and services from the catalog. Mm-hmm. When the virtual agent is not able to fix the problem, Neva picks up and makes recommendations in the context of the incident or the request for the human agent.
Okay.
So it makes the human agent smarter.
Sure.
And for the manager, there's a dashboard that uses the automation-related conversations that requesters are having with the virtual agent to provide predictive analytics. And the 4th use case is what we call auto mapping, that uses the machine learning-based prediction engine to do auto routing or auto categorization to essentially route around the kind of typical catch and release mechanism that's often used by an L1 call center.
Cool. So with a lot of focus coming into the market right now around AI and machine learning, you're seeing a lot of venture capital money enter the space. You're seeing a lot of new players kind of outside the traditional service management markets enter the space. You know, what do you guys think is your unique approach to the market? You know, why are you guys going to be successful, especially in the ServiceNow adjacent space?
So we very explicitly and unapologetically focus on how AI and machine learning can be used to deliver better business outcomes.
Okay.
So it just so happens that these new technologies are very well suited to IT's kind of vision, or, you know, the holy grail of IT as a provider of strategic services to the business, a source of creating compelling technology experiences for the business. Okay. And we think that when the business outcome that you're trying to deliver is, you know, call deflection or reduced MTTR or better customer SAT scores, it turns out that in a lot of those cases, AI and machine learning are good technologies to be applied in support of those business
yeah.
goals, but we make sure that they're not ends in and of themselves.
Yeah,
I think that's
that makes sense. That absolutely makes sense.
So when you're going through an implementation of that, obviously you need some data to be based on and to work from. How long does that take to start getting enough input to see those patterns? And that's basically what it's doing in large part, right? You know, the algorithms are seeing certain patterns and certain tendencies to make those suggestions. So how long does that take for an organization to start generating enough raw data to be statistically accurate? Have you done metrics and stuff around that?
Yeah. So as in the case of all supervised machine learning, more data tends to lead to better
sure.
predictions.
Yeah. Sure.
In terms of time to value, the model typically trains in at or less than a week.
Oh, that's quick.
At which point you have a dedicated API endpoint, which in the case of the ServiceNow integration, which we're proud at K17, we're launching the first certified app. Mm-hmm. It's an AI platform built native in ServiceNow.
Oh, cool.
And within about a week, you've got APIs where you can make predictions into any field in any form
right.
in ServiceNow.
Wow.
And that's, you know, to yep. Shane's question about the uniqueness, we think that's a pretty differentiated approach.
Yeah, and I mean, personally, you know, with my clients and stuff, I don't think a week is a long time, you know.
Yeah, I think it's really gonna depend on the amount of data that's churning through. If you're in an environment
sure.
that has a lot of fast turn data around incident management, knowledge management, things of that nature, the machine's going to learn faster.
Sure.
You know, that's the machine learning aspect. How are you guys approaching that? Like from a knowledge management point of view, you know, where you go into an environment where they have tons of knowledge, you know, articles, how are you teaching the system to learn which ones are relevant to what subjects?
Yeah. So one of the other unique approaches of Neva is that we don't assume that on day one, there's going to be a rich repository of knowledge content.
Yep.
It's hard to make that assumption.
I was going to say, that's a very good assumption.
Yes.
Yeah. So we actually architected the platform so that Neva's ingesting a combination of private enterprise data to the extent you have historical incidents, change records, problems, knowledge content, CMDB ideally CMDB mapped to business services.
Yeah.
But if you don't, Neva can also index public content, like say, Apple support forums or Stack Overflow exchanges, so that you're combining, you know, all of the sources where the answer may live.
So you're mining publicly available data that is generalized for, you know, the type of support that every company needs, but at the same time looking internally at the private data to kind of mine that for things that are unique for that particular environment.
Yeah. The thesis is Neva's responsibility is to minimize the distance between the question and the answer, wherever it may live. And in some cases, the best answer doesn't live within the four walls of the enterprise.
So are you guys seeing any resistance in the market? Especially I'm thinking of kind of the service desk agents. There's this fear that the machines are coming to take people's jobs. And that's a kind of a really real conversation that's happening in the industry right now. What are you guys doing and the customers that you're talking to kind of overcome that fear?
Yeah. First and foremost, one of the things I think is most misunderstood about the role that AI and machine learning are and will play in the IT domain is that for the most part, the use cases actually involve augmenting the capabilities of the human agent. So today, three of the four use cases I mentioned involve making the human smart faster using machine learning.
So you're trying to actually amplify the human aspects and make those people more efficient, more effective, rather than fully replace them in many cases.
Harness the power of your data
to
surface better answers faster.
Excellent.
Right. So that's one thing that you see. I mean, and I've spoken to folks about, and it sounds like you guys really play into this. You're taking a lot of the work maybe that would have to go to a level two or a level three. And if you can provide that capability at level one, it's less expensive.
Yeah.
It's quicker. I mean, it's all good with that regard. So like I said, the customer's happier, faster, and the company's happier because it costs them a lot less. Yeah. So I would think that stuff doesn't go away. And to your point, Shane, people are worried about the work going away of that level one. So no, it's like their work shifts from data entry and passing it along to actually solving problems and solving issues and leaving the real techies to do more technical work rather than administrative work. So is that part of the discussion that you have when you're going into clients and that value proposition essentially? Is that what you guys really talk to them about?
It is
or one of
the ultimate realization of the shift left strategy.
Okay.
Right? You're taking things that only your specialists, your L2 and your L3 could do, and you're now empowering the L1 because all of the best resources that were historically in the heads of the L2s and the L3, now are surfaced in the form of machine learning-based recommendations for your L1.
Right.
So what do you think is the biggest obstacle we as an industry need to overcome to kind of advance a lot of the AI machine learning aspects of IT service and support and all of these other things that we're going to try and tackle with it?
Yeah, I think shifting the conversation away from one that is technology-driven and to one that is business outcome-driven.
Absolutely.
I think when we think about it in terms of augmenting the capabilities of our agents with better answers faster, then you quickly kind of cut through the fear and the confusion around the role of AI, and it becomes one that's back to the KPIs and the business outcomes that we've always been trying to improve.
Yeah. You got to show them where they fit in that story in the future. So that's great.
Positive business outcomes. How many, we've been talking about that for years. That's what it's really good.
Absolutely.
Well, thank you very much for coming. We enjoyed talking with you. Look forward to talk to you again as keep making more progress.
Likewise. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.